First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
All right. You know what time it is. It's time for Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, a.k.a. Brother Booker T. Coleman Jr., and he's going to be teaching on today, brain expansion and the development of indigenous cultures. Brother Kaba, are you there?
My brother, I am here. Hotep, salam.
Hotep, how you doing today?
My brother, I'm doing excellent. How you doing?
Oh, we doing well. Everybody ready for you?
All right, brother, I'm ready for us.
Okay, all right. All right, let me start off with the correlation between the brain development and indigenous cultures. Would you say that there's been indigenous cultures in which that existed prior to the culture that we live in today, or this modern day culture in which that was far more advanced? And what is your take on the reason why?
Well, it appears to me just when you go back and you look at the original peoples of the planet and how they developed their societies, all facets of the society, whether it was the economics, the politics, the education, you know, the societal itself, you know, how the society functioned, you could see that it was all leaning towards what might be called the perfection of the planet and the perfection of the human being. That was the purpose of the reason for living, and everything that we did during our lives would lead towards that. The world that we're living in today, everything is leaning towards material possessions. And so therefore, your willingness to head down the wrong road is decided upon by, well, am I going to get paid? And as you look around, you can see so many people, whether it is in entertainment or whether it's in sports, that are able to succeed economically, and they're not necessarily doing the right thing. And like in entertainment, of course, we know that there are women that can move ahead by creating sex tapes, and there are men that can get ahead by saying things that are inappropriate as to the development of society. In other words, gangster and violence and aggression and disrespect towards women. And in sports, you know, I mean, when you look at what just happened the other day, and again, I try to avoid using names because that just starts pointing fingers. I just like to talk about the issue as opposed to the individuals in the issue, where you have people who are using performance-enhancing drugs. And if they can make money by playing better on drugs, then they can be exonerated for using drugs. Even though they may stand before a group of people and tell an untruth, they still can get off because basically they brought the system money. And so the society that we're living in today is judged by your material wealth. And you don't have to be honest. You do not have to have integrity to be able to attain that. In the original societies, that just wasn't happening. That was not accepted. And it's not that it may not have been done, but if there was an inkling that that's how you got what you got, you would be shunned from the society. You would no longer be honored. You would no longer be respected. You would not be one of the societal peoples anymore, and they would shun you. They would put you away. They would never even mention your name again. It's like you never existed. And that was the punishment for that type of action. And so the way in which the brain functioned, that is why, you know, I've done some research on the brain. I would say particularly over the past couple of years, I've been really looking at the brain as an educator. You know, for those who may not know me, my brother El-Bey, I'd like to just give some background so folks
please
might
do,
understand, you know, my background. I'm an educator here in New York City, taught in the Bronx all of my career. I taught for 31 years, a little over 31 years, in South Central Bronx. And I call it graduation. Some people call it retirement. But I retired in July 2009, and I've been doing consultant work, and I've been doing independent work, and I've been doing different types of lectures and presentations since then. But I've been focused on the brain because I realized that, you know, particularly as teachers, and we're all teachers to tell you the truth, no matter if you so-called have a degree or not. But one of the things I've realized, my brother, is that if you don't understand the brain, how the brain functions as a teacher, it's equivalent to being a brain surgeon and never studied brain anatomy. How can you teach entity that you don't know? And so I've developed brain anatomy classes as it relates to learning and teaching, but specifically for the African mind, because something very interesting happened to the African mind that transformed the way in which they received and gave off information. The enslavement of African people in the diaspora and the colonialization of African people on the continent, it shifted the way in which the African brain functioned, the original brain functioned. When you look here in America, the indigenous peoples of America, what is so very interesting as I've researched the indigenous population, the great majority of people, when they look at indigenous populations, they don't even understand who they were and what made them up and exactly who the indigenous people were. And that is, of course, we know why, but I mean, without that information and without that understanding, when you go into the American history books, even American history as taught in Western civilization, not just in the United States history books, but in the world history books that look at American history, when you study indigenous populations, you basically begin and are looking at the indigenous populations from a European perspective. You begin with the indigenous peoples on the East Coast, specifically, basically, the Northeast Coast. And then you do a westward whole thing. You go from the East Coast to the West Coast because that's the way Europeans encountered Native American peoples as they traveled. But to really and truly understand indigenous populations, you would have to understand the Mississippi River. And you'd have to really understand the vitality and the genius that really found its flourishing and its growth. You're going to see along the Mississippi River As you travel from the southern part of the country, which might be considered New Orleans, straight up through where it branches off, one part to the Mississippi and the other to the Ohio River, and yet we don't even understand this concept, that you cannot understand indigenous people from a Western perspective. You've got to look at it from an indigenous perspective. And this is where you come upon the pyramids of America. And as you begin to flourish across north and east and west and going down into Central America and Mexico and South America and into the Caribbean, you begin to encounter the same type of genius amongst the indigenous peoples. But you've got to understand who the indigenous people are to even understand the intelligence that would have been brought forward. So my focus has been on the brain and to understand how the brain functions. And one thing I came to realize is that this enslavement and colonial process, it did something to the neurons in the brains of the peoples that were being attacked. And it's called disassociation. And in disassociation, that led to the forgetting, let's say, of who they are, where they came from, and all things in between. And that's why I focus.
Go ahead. Brother Kaba?
Yes, brother, I'm here. I just stopped to give you a chance if you had a question or if you wanted to respond, or because I know sometimes we can go on and on talking, but sometimes, I need to give you a chance to get in here and say whatever you'd like or if you have a question or anything else.
Oh, yes, I just want to bring this out. Now, we were talking about the brain aspect. Now, of course, scientists would tell us that we only use on average about 10% of our brain. With the dissociation in which that you spoke of, what would be methods in order to reintegrate, what information or what knowledge or understanding or comprehension do we need in order to reintegrate what has been disassociated or what has been forgotten in order to lead us back to utilizing more than just the 10% usage of our brain in which their scientists now state the average person uses?
Okay. Now, what's interesting is this. Let me take us back for a minute, and let's look at us as a people. Let's go to Africa. I could tell the same story in America, but let me use Africa as an example, where you have children in a community that have been brought up in a community, and we can use Ghana, we can use Congo, we can use Nigeria, we can use Sierra Leone, whatever you want to use, we can use that nation. But let's just look and just take a nation, but know that it could be applied to any nation anywhere. Take a nation, you have these children that go out and they're playing amongst themselves. The little boys and the little girls, they're chasing each other, they're throwing pebbles into the water. They have been brought up in a society that has developed an oral tradition. It has its own language. It has its way of expressing of that which is not necessarily love, justice, righteousness, respect, honor, things that are important, people who are important to the community. And these young people are learning this. And this is what they're embedded in, and this is the way their mind is functioning. When they learn these different things, whatever it may have been, in the brain, amongst the neurons, there is a relationship between neuron to neuron. The brain basically is made up of, and if I may just say this, just so I can go through it, just so I could have said it, so that we can understand this, because this is what I mean when I say as a people we have to study. We really have to start to study and study hard to understand what has happened and what we have to do. It's one thing to know what happened to us. It's more important, what are we going to do despite what happened to us? The brain basically is made up, let's just say, of neurons. These are cells. These are the cells in the brain. And the neurons are made up of what's called a cell body, and then it has an axon and it has a dendrite. And for every impulse, every thought, everything that we experience in our eyes, what we see, what we hear, what we smell, what we touch, what we taste, what we feel, messages are sent from axon to dendrite, from neuron to neuron. There is a space between each neuron called a synapse. And the information that is going from one neuron to another is escorted from the axon to the dendrite by a neurotransmitter or a ligand. Okay. Everything that we learn, everything that we experience is based on sending that message from axon to dendrite. So when everything that we learn, that young people, those young people in that society that were learning about their culture, learning through their language, learning their history, learning their rituals and their ceremonies, that is what's called the association of neurons. In other words, you are associating experiences that's creating a way of thinking. And out of this way of thinking is created your behavior, and out of your behavior comes your personality. Imagine these young people playing in this community, and all of a sudden, a group of people that don't look anything like them, they've never seen them before, don't know them, they come on very ferociously and very violently. They beat the children. They put them in chains, and they beat them. What is happening at that point that they are captured? They begin to disassociate. In other words, they begin to recircuit their thought processes to the experience that they're having at that moment. So it's called disassociation. As these young children and these Africans are dragged across from their community to this other place, being spoken in a language they don't understand, looking at people that they have never seen before, going into geographic terrain that they've never walked across, there's a process of disassociation from the person they were into the person that they are becoming. They are then brought to a dungeon, put down, mistreated, not fed well. They are attacked. Again, more disassociation is happening. This is what's happening in the brain. They're put on a ship, and they're brought to a land that they never saw before, don't know anything about it. They are with other people that look like them but may not be speaking the same language that they speak. So there's no way they can communicate with each other. So there's further disassociation even from the people that look like them. So this is I'm telling this story in a way that we can understand that by the time you get from the point that these people are enslaved to the generations later who are now going to be enslaved in the American hemisphere, who are going to be treated the way in which African people were treated during the enslavement process, there is a disassociation from a people. But the one thing to remember is that although the neurons are disassociated, the information is transferred into the subconscious brain. It's forgotten, but it's not lost. And that's very important to understand. So that, let's step up where we are right now. In our schools and in everything we experience, what we need to do is to disassociate what those children have learned transgenerationally from the day they were enslaved. We need to disassociate and associate those neurons back to the way they were before the enslavement process. And that is when you begin to do what Dr. Naeem Akbar talks about in his book, Know Thyself. He says you have to deconstruct, reconstruct, and then construct. You have to deconstruct white supremacy, which is the experience we had from when they invaded our communities in Africa. We have to reconstruct, which is learning our history and learning our language. This is why I say that as an African people, I am suggesting that we make Meduneter, or hieroglyphs, our classical African language. And I am encouraging us to make Kiswahili our practical spoken language. In other words, Kiswahili is the largest African language spoken in the world. It is the seventh largest language spoken in the world. And while I respect all languages, whether it be Twi, or whether it be Yoruba, or whether it be Congo or Luaba, I respect them all. However, we grew up, growing up in our community, with Kiswahili basically being, Kiswahili is the language of Kwanzaa. Kiswahili is the language that was exposed to us growing up from, let's say, the 60s on. You know, I remember in the Black Panther Party, that was the first time I ever heard Kiswahili spoken. And they taught us Kiswahili. So that the language becomes extremely important. And so we have to begin to look at the development of language. And Medunete, or what the Greeks misnomered hieroglyphs, means the same thing, sacred writing. That should be our classical language. Like Greek is the classical language for the Western world, Medunete should be the classical language for the African world. And Kiswahili, if I go to Holland and the brothers and sisters speak Dutch, I speak English, we should be able to speak to each other in Kiswahili. If I go to Brazil and the Africans speak Portuguese, I speak English, we should speak to each other in Kiswahili. Is this going to be done? It's just a recommendation, suggestion from a brother that's just trying to find common ground. And so we have got to now begin to associate back where we were before we were interrupted by the Urugu. And so that this is why the brain becomes so very important, because going back to your original, and then I'll take a pause, there are two parts of the brain that we have to look at very seriously, and they're both located in a particular part of our brain. Basically, our brain is in three areas. We basically have a brain stem. On top of the brain stem, we have the limbic system. And on top of the limbic system, we have the neocortex. Fundamentally speaking, the brain stem, which is at the bottom where the spinal cord is and comes down into the neck, and the spinal cord comes out of the brain stem, that is a reptilian. That is the earliest brain that living organisms had. Out of that came the limbic system. They're responsible for your feelings, and your neocortex is responsible for your thinking. In your limbic system, which is responsible for your feeling, a lot of learning and a lot of teaching. As teachers, we should be teaching to the limbic system, allowing the neocortex to think about what the limbic system is feeling and what the R complex or the brainstem is receiving. In the limbic system, you have two important pieces there. You have what's called the amygdala, A-M-Y-G-D-A-L-A, and you have the hippocampus, H-I-P-P-O-C-A-M-P-U-S. Very important parts of the brain, and I'm going to tell you why. The amygdala has a lot to do with fear. It has a lot to do with those feelings we have of fear. The hippocampus is responsible for your long-term memory, things that you remember for a very long time. I'm sure that everyone listening can go back into their memory and remember a teacher that really stood out in their mind, a person that really stood out in their mind, an event that occurred, it really stood out in their mind. When you remember that in the long-term memory, it is in your hippocampus that is responsible. If ever you experience something that brings great fear to you, it gives you apprehension, that is the amygdala. If you were walking down the street and saw this huge anaconda snake, the amygdala is what's going to make you register that snake, and it's going to create a fear. In our classrooms, Western civilization and education in the Western civilization is based on fear. You must pass this test. You've got to learn this information. You're a failure if you don't pass it. You're worthless. You don't learn. You can't learn. You're ignorant. You're stupid. When information is received in the amygdala, it locks it in the amygdala and doesn't let it get to the hippocampus. And so this amygdala locks the information from getting to the hippocampus. So when a student takes a test and is scared, they have the anxiety of taking the test, or they don't remember because the information isn't in their long-term memory, it's in their amygdala because it was put in prison in the amygdala, because when they learned it through fear. And one of the things I tell teachers is that you've got to make your classrooms a safe haven. You've got to make it a comfortable place. You've got to make it a place where children feel free. I'm not saying without discipline. I am saying to feel free, to be happy that they're in that room, to be happy that they're with you. But when they're afraid of you, then they will, the only thing they'll really remember of you is that they were afraid of you. The other things they'll remember of you is the horrible things you did to them. But if you ask them to remind you of something that you really learned in their class that was worthwhile, sometimes they couldn't even let you know that. And so that's why it's important to understand the brain, because our experience in being enslaved, everything we experienced has been locked in our amygdala. And we're not, and many of us don't want to remember the pain. We've got to begin a new process of educating our children. We must do it. Folk ask me, can a white person, can a person of European descent teach? Well, my response is, yes, they can. I mean, that's only real. There are very good teachers of all different backgrounds out there. What I say is they shouldn't. We need to take the education in our own hands and educate our children. And I have nothing against anybody under any circumstances, but we ought to be educating our own children. But to do that, it's hypocritical unless I'm willing to say we need to go on a crusade to encourage young people to become future teachers. I'm on a crusade for teachers. I want young people, when they say, what should I do, what should I become a teacher. Some people will say be a doctor, some will say a lawyer, some even say become president. I say become a teacher. And this way we'll go into those classrooms. Because I'll be honest with you, with due respect to the European-American female teachers, you can't teach a black male child. You just don't have that experience to be able to explain to them what it is like to be an adult. You can't even teach a European-American child what it's like to be a young man. You can imagine what it's like to, for a European-American female to teach a young African-American male how to be a young African-American male in America.
That's interesting. And I really do feel that that is the absolute truth of the matter. Now, you said something very interesting about the reptilian portion of the brain. That takes me back to when the president, Obama, was on The View a few months ago, in which that he spoke about that there's people in which that, you know, have the reptilian portion of the brain activated, in which that these are the reasons why for the misunderstandings and the differences within society, because they have not been able to bypass that particular point. And that's interesting in what you're saying about how the fear factor becomes locked within the amygdala glands. That's very important, you know, and that's one of the most perfect ways I've ever heard it specified, you know, and examined in details, you know. So now, when you look at the individuals who are locked at the amygdalas or locked down into below the limbics, into the, you know, reptilian portion of the brain, you know, and oftentimes we have heard these stories about people who are the so-called said elite and how they are, you know, locked into that particular area of the brain. And due to that fact, they become, easy tools in order to, for possession. I don't want to go into that particular realm, but I do want to deal with the issue of the reptilian portion of the brain. And like you said, it's very hard for people to teach each other if they're from different, environments, race, sex, you know, those become issues within the teaching community. So what is it in which that you would give to us as far as a said cure to that particular thing? Would it be something similar to like the way that the Nation of Islam does it, in which that they have the women on one side and the women have their MGT classes, or the brothers have their FOI classes? I mean, how do you see, I guess, the cure for that particular thought ailment?
When you say that, brother, are you speaking of us as an African people coming together to educate ourselves?
Yes, particularly.
Okay. There are certain, the way I would formulate classrooms and schools, I think it's extremely important that we understand when male and female should be together and when they should not be together. In math and science class, they should not be together. In social studies class, they can be together. In language arts class, they can be together sometime. In lunch, they can be together. In art, they can be together. In music, they can be together. But there are certain subjects, because of the nature of the male and the female brain, and it's not that either one will learn something different. That's not my point. It's that the way in which the brain receives the information in the world we're living in today, in the world we're living in today, and that's very important to understand, because we are not back in Africa. We are not back where we eat the kinds of foods that promote the feminine principle and the male principle. There are certain foods to eat for testosterone. There are certain foods to eat for estrogen. That's just the way it flows. That's the way the body is made. Not one is superior to the other, but it is just, they're different.
That's right.
In our society, we're always dealing with superior, inferior, better, worse, good, bad. In Africa, you didn't have that conceptual framework. So that it was very different from the framework. The psychological factor was very different. But in the schools that we have today, there are times that they should be together, and there are some times that the class should be all female and taught by a female, and there are times that the class should be all male and taught by a male. There are times they should be together where they're taught by male and female. There are times that males should be taught by females, and there are times that females should be taught by males. But in Africa, we had Ma'at. We knew how to balance. This society is not balanced. It doesn't understand how to balance the feminine and male principle. Each and every human being is both male and female simultaneously. I am both man and woman. I have mother. I have father. I am half my mother and I'm half my father, but I'm very uniquely me. And so when I'm in the presence of a woman, and she is instructing me in a way that would go along the feminine principle, she is talking to the woman in me, my mother's principle. And the same with a male teacher to a female. He is talking to her father in her. Africans understood this balance, my brother El-Bey. They did it beautifully, too. That's why the natures are both male and female. And as Dr. Ben tells us, you cannot have a god and not have a goddess.
That's right.
And that's how it was broken down in Africa. It was very straightforward. And you see, when we got into this European male Christian-dominated society, there are some more disassociations that are going on. We are disassociating ourselves from the respect of the female and understanding the role of the female. And so now here we are, acting in ways unlike who we really and truly are. And even countries in Africa that have been contaminated by the Western mind act like that too. But if you go back into the communities that have not been touched by European mind, they don't act like that. They don't act like that at all. But wherever the vampire bite, come the vampire.
And that's one of the things that we were talking about, you know, that reptilian portion, or as you were saying, the fear being trapped within the amygdala.
Yeah.
Those particular portions of the brain are necessary to be fully activated so that it can move the energy up into the neocortex of the brain in order to bring forth awareness and thinking on a higher level. In other words, in tune with our higher nature, our higher self. So,
that's right.
Would that be one of the ills in which that is within society, in which that has man has fallen, you know, as you say, fallen humanity, you know?
Well, you know, when the African left Africa and went into the northern part of the planet and began to depigment itself, and the pineal gland, which is in the limbic system, began to become calcified. You know, a calcified pineal gland, your pineal gland is located in what's called your ventricular system in the brain. It's located in the third ventricle. And your pineal gland, under healthy conditions, looks like a grape. In the Ice Age, the pineal gland became calcified or hardened. And when you examine what a calcified pineal gland looks like, it looks like a raisin.
Right.
And
sure
so you have a healthy pineal gland that looks like a grape, which is plump and bursting with liquids.
Right, and go for blood.
Yeah, and then you have the calcified, which its life waters has been hardened and drained out of it.
Right, atrophied. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. And in so doing, brother, when this mind came back amongst healthy pineal gland, it brought its disease with it.
Mm.
And it spread its disease across the planet. And in order to survive, people with a healthy pineal gland had to think unhealthily.
Mm.
Came a problem because... You know, I mean, even to this day, brother, you know, I speak for myself. A lot of, I shouldn't say a lot, but some of my thoughts deal with how am I going to pay the rent this month and make sure I got food on the table for the family and, you know, paying my bills and making sure. You know, back in Africa, you know, we didn't worry about those things. Those are things that never crossed our mind.
You right.
We knew we were going to eat. Nature gave us the food. We knew we were looking at the mango tree, and we were looking at our farms, and we knew that food was going to come, unless we had a bad season. But we knew where food was coming. We didn't worry about being put out of our home because we built our home. We knew that we had a home. We never worried about clothing. We knew we had clothing. We knew we would see tomorrow. But we're living in a world today where things that we should never, ever have to worry about, we have to worry about.
That's true.
The nature of the beast.
Right.
That's just the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
If I had my way, I'd go all over do my work for free.
Right.
But if I got to pay my bills, I got to charge.
Yeah, I understand completely.
To a minimum... But this is how we have to think. So in many ways, all of us, myself included, think on that level.
Right.
I'll be the first to admit it. But this is what we're living in. So what you try to do is you try to transform lemons into lemonade. You try to do the best that you possibly can, causing the least amount of harm on the least amount of nature's entities, people, plants, and animals. That's all you can do.
Right.
And that art complex, man, was the early brain of the savage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was that fight or flight part of the brain.
Right, that reptilian part. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man, when you look at what's going on in Congress right now, man, them folk are reptilian to the core.
Right.
These folk ain't using their brains at all. They are living in their reptilian complex.
You're right. No doubt about it.
The decisions they make come out of their reptilian complex.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because they realize their time is up.
Right.
Noble Drew Ali told him that.
Right.
Elijah Muhammad told him that. Martin Luther King told him that. Right. Malcolm promised them that.
That's right. And Elijah Muhammad said that we don't have to lift up the gun because nature will take care of it. That's right.
As we speak, we're looking at it.
Yeah.
Their time is up, brother. But the real question is, what are we going to do when their time is up? Are we ready ourselves? Are we ready to teach ourselves? Are we ready to feed ourselves? We got to get ourselves together. So my question isn't when it's going to happen for them. The question is, what's going to happen
for us
amongst us?
Right. Now,
so we
got to
start using our brother.
Right. Do you think that one of the determining factors may be the activation of our melanin? I know that by reading the Unk book written by, introduction was written by Brother Samaj, Hibber Samaj, who's the husband of Queen of Four, and Brother Nur Ahmed Nur. I know that Nur Ahmed, I knew that in his book he spoke about the fact that in the third dimension, melanin has a gap in between it, in which that acts as a time barrier in a sense, you know. However, when ultraviolet light, with more ultraviolet light or more energy coming in, that gap is filled, you know. And so time, we're then able to pierce the time and space barrier, you know. So melanin, do you think melanin will play a factor in this particular process of us? Because I know also others have said, such as Dr. Richard King, that melanin itself actually is the outside of our external brain.
Well, you know, melanin comes in many different forms. You know, I have a whole series on melanin.
Right.
Where I look into it. And, of course, the first person that I heard the word melanin come out of their mouth was Dr. Richard King back in 1981, I believe, at First World Alliance. I had never heard that word before, and I was a kindergarten teacher at the time, and that was the first time I ever heard that word, and I was just so fascinated by what this brother was talking about. And I had the real pleasure of being able to see him again a couple weeks back at LIU when Eye Opener Productions, Brother Shabazz, brought him all the way from California, from Los Angeles, to present to us, and fantastic Dr. Ann Brown was the one that did the introductory remarks. And there's no question that melanin is everything. Melanin is the universe. Melanin is the blackness from whence all things come, whether it's cosmic, earthly, or organic. And in fact, melanin is activating as we speak. There would be no life if melanin wasn't activating. The question is, how frequently are we activating it? Do we know how to activate it at our will? And are we developing a consciousness that allows it to free flow? Time is history and space is geography, but all things are contained within melanin. There is no part of the universe that is not melanin in one form or another. And so I think that your question, your comment, and what you're saying is absolute. That the activation of the higher forms of melanin, once we understand what this is about, we start eating the proper things, we start to exercise our bodies. Exercise is very important for us, because that activates the melanin, particularly in our muscles and particularly in our skeletal system. It activates our blood system, our circulatory system. It activates our lungs and our brains. It activates our cells. It brings us to life. We have to exercise. We have to eat properly. We have to listen to the proper music and listen to the proper people. We have to intake the proper information. And that will activate the melanin to levels that even we don't know exist, because we've never been there before. We're still caught up in the Western mindset.
That's true.
Until we break that, my brother El-Bey, until we break that. And I believe that, right now, I think out of 100 people, 3 are ready. Fortunately, I don't know if 97, there might be some as you move towards, you know, upper, you know, there might be some ready to get there, but there are 3% of folk that are doing their thing and doing it right.
Right.
And if there's 30 million black folk in America, 3% of 30 million is 90,000. And that's not a bad number to start with.
Right. All right, all right. Now, you sent me a template of a curriculum. Are there any points that you want to go over as far as the curriculum is concerned? Because I think that is something in which that we all need to be utilizing, especially for those who are homeschooling the children, as well as those who have after-school programs. I think that curriculum is necessary, you know, that you put together, because it has the basics of our survival within it based on the information in which that comes from all of the teachers, in which that you, myself, and others have sat at the feet of these particular masters, such as John Henry Clark, Dr. Ben Yakinen, so forth and so on. So any particular points you want to build on that?
Well, one thing I'd like to say, Brother El-Bey, and I appreciate you allowing me these moments to speak on this, is that I will attach anybody interested in the study guide that I sent to you. I will send it to anybody who emails me, and I will attach it back to you in the email. And there is no charge for this. Because to me, and I'll tell you how it happened, because I've been doing this work for a very long time. And I've been putting together my curriculums, I've been putting together my ideas, I've been putting together my outlines as to the curriculum itself and what we should be studying. And that was at the direction of Dr. John Henry Clark, who I give credit to being my Jagna, or who I consider to be my teacher. Talking years ago, man, when I was a young man, because I met him when I was 12 and a half, I didn't realize his importance in my life until I was like in my late teens, going into my 20s and my earlier 20s. I was trying to, I asked him how I could best contribute to our community. And he told me that there would be people that would be principals, there would be people that would have buildings, there would be people who would have money, there was people who would support a school for us. He said, but what we need is a curriculum. I spent my life attempting to develop a curriculum. What it is that we need to know and how to implement the teaching process. This is how I got involved in my research on the human brain. So what I shared with you, the first part of it, because I teach college. I'm in the Black Studies Department at State University of New York at New Paltz. It's 82 miles north of New York City. And I teach a course on Malcolm X. I teach a course on the introduction to Africa. And I've courses on the Moors. Of course, they wouldn't accept it if I said the Moors, so I called the course the African Presence in Medieval Europe. But it's really a course on the Moors. I teach a course on the African presence in early America. I taught a course on Kush and Kemet. And so what you'll notice in the beginning of that study guide that I shared with you, you'll see me go through, it's like a college syllabus, breaks down 15 classes on how to study this material. It tells you the books that you should read and the pages you should read as you go through the 15 sessions of a particular class. You know, I just don't say read this book. I take you through the chapters that are most appropriate, and I combine books so that you can get theme going in each section.
Now, before you go any further, let me ask you this. Why is it that they fear the name Moore? You know, from your perspective, I mean, why is it that you just have to say African instead of you can utilize the word Moor, being that they know that the Moors ruled Europe for over 800 years, from 711 A.D. to 1492 A.D. and beyond? I mean, what is your take on that?
But they associate Moor with Muslim with Arab.
Mm.
They don't see as the African.
Right.
And so, therefore, they talk about the Arab influence in Europe.
Right. Or the high priesthood of Anubis out of ancient Canaan. You know.
Say that again.
Of course, they was the priesthood from out of ancient Canaan.
Africans were the caretakers of the Kemetic wisdom and knowledge.
Right, exactly.
And that's what they brought into Europe, but they'll never recognize the word more.
Right.
And because I don't feel like arguing with people who don't understand it from the get-go, I just want to teach it. If they tell me, if I say the African presence in medieval Europe, and I can teach about the Moors, that's what I'm going to say.
Oh, I got you.
But I'm not going to fight them over the word more.
Right.
Because I want to teach the class.
Right.
But I really taught a course on the Moors when I taught that class. I just had to phrase it differently for it to get through the department.
Right.
Not the Black Studies department, but the Social Science department. Black Studies had no problem with it. In fact, I was encouraged to teach that class. God, I shared with you, you'll see that I have listed those courses that because I've taught all those courses. Those are courses I taught in college. And then I get into a piece that's called 40 Seasons. Now, that really is my lifelong. That has been the culmination of my life's work. That's the second part of the study guide. The third part of the study guide is my DVD catalog. That lists the DVDs that I have. But anyone who would like to get a copy of this study guide, and now let me tell you how this all came into existence and why I did it when I did it. I did it end of April, because I had a chance to be in a documentary called Hidden Colors. Hidden Colors was put together by a brother by the name of Tariq Nasheed, California. And Hidden Colors premiered in movie houses around the country, and it premiered on April 16th of 2011 in New York in a movie house down on 12th Street right off of Broadway. And what Tariq Nasheed did, because of his other work that he does in entertainment, he put it on World Star Hip Hop. Many young people who go to World Star Hip Hop, and anyone who's familiar with World Star Hip Hop, you know what I'm talking about. They went to the premiere. And after the first showing, I stepped outside. And a lot of the young people came out and said, yo, man, I didn't know this was going to be like this. I thought it was going to be Nicki Minaj, and I thought it was going to be Drake and Lil Wayne. I thought it was going to be hip-hop-ish. You're going to drop that knowledge on the Moors and drop the knowledge on Africans in Asia. They said, now you open me up, where do I go with this? The second showing, young people came out and said the same thing, and I said, you know something? There was so much information in Hidden Colors from people such as Dr. Phil Valentine and Dr. Francis Chris Welsing and our good brother Umar Johnson and Shahrazad Ali, giving out this information, Brother Sabir Bey. All of these brothers and sisters giving out all this information was overwhelming for a lot of our people who never knew this existed and who had come to the showing thinking that they were going to see something on hip-hop. So I said, I need to at least offer people who want to take this information to the next level. I need to offer them something that they can begin to go into their own research. So that's why I developed this study guide. And this study guide, as you can see, is approximately 37, 38 pages. It is free for anyone who is interested. If they contact me by my email, if I may give them my email address, brother?
Yes.
K-A-M as in Mary, E, N as in Nancy, E, 777 at AOL.com. K-A-M-E-N-E, 777 at AOL.com. If you email me, I will attach back to you this study guide free of charge because I believe that this is something that should be in the hands of our community to be able to understand, as you say, with the homeschoolers, people who just want to educate themselves or their children. This is a good guide they can use to begin the process and it takes them through a way that they could understand and would be able to teach it.
Well, we are using it on our online school, you know, as more. So we are definitely utilizing it. We appreciate you for sending it to us, and it's being utilized, you know. As a matter of fact, we have some questions also. So we're going to go to the board, and we're going to get to area code 253, area code 253.
Dr. Coleman, peace, El-Bey, how's it going?
Peace,
all
brother,
right.
Man, hotel.
That's a very powerful information right here. I'm really digging it. I'm about to send you the email right now as soon as I can click the compose button. What I want to know is there anything that
before
you
press that compose button, please make sure you put study guide so I'll know it's for the study guide.
Study guide, no problem. Okay. Not a problem. What I was wondering, is there like anything you could do for the brain, any kind of herbs, like what type of foods can you intake to help enhance the brain, like with memory or anything like that? And also, could you explain the benefits of sunlight on the brain as well?
Well, okay. In terms of food and things you can do, number one thing, of course, eat many green things, healthy green things. I like collard greens. I like all the greens, to tell you the truth, but kale is very good for the brain. Anything green, deep green, is good for the brain because it has oxygen. And because it has oxygen, it brings oxygen to the brain, and the brain needs as much oxygen as it can possibly get to have a healthy development of neuromelanin. Another thing you can do for the brain is to practice deep breathing exercises, to make sure that you are bringing oxygen to the brain. Of course, try to be around a healthy place. You know, have some plants in your house that give off the kind of oxygen that you need.
Correct.
You know, have plants that you grow and that you care for and that, you know, you help to develop. And then out of that concept, your deep breathing exercises, if you happen to have these plants in a particular room, go into that room and practice deep breathing exercise in order to get oxygen to come to the brain. Because really, as Dr. Sabi and Sister Ma'a teaches us, you know, a healthy cell is a cell that has the ability to intake oxygen. It helps it breathe. And when it breathes, it's healthy. And this is why, you know, when the children used to take those standardized tests or any tests, we used to do deep breathing exercises before we even looked at the exam. It's also very important to know how to take deep breathing exercises. And many people have different ways, but I would just recommend that you just make sure you take deep breathing exercises frequently during your day. Go off to the side and just attempt to deep breathe and just take in that good, great oxygen. If you're in a park or you're near a park, go to that park and practice breathing. If you're walking somewhere and you have a chance to walk through the street or walk through a park, considering safety at all times, go through the park, deep breathe. So I think that's addressing the first part. The second part is the sunlight hits your pineal gland. Throughout many of the pictures that we see in ancient Kemet, you can see a relationship between sunlight and the pineal gland, which is the doorway to your unconscious. And remember, we spoke earlier about all of those memories that this horrific experience called the Ma'afa, the terroristic disaster of being enslaved or colonized, has put on us. When you allow yourself to go back into your unconscious, or if you want to call it your subconscious, I don't care what you call it, because basically you're either on or you're off. You either remember or you don't remember. But whatever it is, the sun allows you, once the sunlight begins to bathe your pineal gland. Also, if you put a finger up to where your pineal gland is, which is right above your brow, and it's right there where you see many people from different Western societies, they put a blue dot in the middle of their forehead. That's where your pineal gland is. If you go into the front of your head, and if you go into the center of your head, the intersecting line between those two pineal gland is located. Sunlight allows the activation, the opening of the stargate, to allow you to go reach deep inside your subconscious or the deeper areas of your brain, the antechambers of your brain, to go deep inside and to pull those memories forward. And the sunlight allows and helps you through that process. With the foods that you may eat, with the proper sunlight that you're receiving, drinking water also brings oxygen to your body. Because a lot of times, a lot of the things that happen in your brain sometimes can be activated by things you do for your body. Vice versa.
Thank you for that question, caller. I'm going to go on to the next caller. Appreciate you. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
Hotel. You'll go to caller 757. 757 is the area code. Come on, name.
Please, my brother, can you ask them where the caller's originating from, just so I can get a sense of who we're talking to, where we're talking from?
Yeah, 757 is Virginia area.
Okay, how about the other one, the 253?
253, I don't know.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
You on the line. Yes, you on the air.
Yes, how you doing, Dr. Alim El-Bey? This is
all right, you're doing well.
Brother Alim El, calling from Virginia. I just want to tell Dr. Kaba I really loved and appreciated his work on Hidden Colors.
Hotel.
I spoke to Dr. Alim El-Bey. I work with Dr. Karam with the Kalu Center. He's actually on the line. He's trying to get in as well. But everything Dr. Kaba was saying is such on point. It's what's needed now in today's age. So many people are focused on getting knowledge and information for themselves. It's like a drug that they don't even care or even think about the effects of the children. You know what I'm saying? So many times we go to lectures and we listen to these people, but where are the children at? You know what I'm saying? So I really appreciate what he's doing. I definitely sent an email, and I hope that we can correspond in the future. And I just want to kind of big up and thank you for having him on your show, and I want to thank him for coming on the show, definitely.
So I definitely
but,
for coming on. And,
yes, man, hope tap. And you know what's interesting is what you say is absolutely true, because everything that from what I have researched, and from what I look at, and you see, what I always tell anybody that listens, my classes, anybody, is I ask them, don't believe a word I say, because I don't say the work that I do is not to make you believe me, it is to make you think. The greatest thing that a facilitator or a teacher can do is to make you think, not necessarily to agree with them. So I find people who may not necessarily disagree with what I say, it's all right. I don't have a problem with that, because I'm not trying to get you to believe me. I'm just trying to get you to think. And if you don't agree with me, it's obvious that I made you think, because at least you know you don't agree with me. So I can go with that. And I think that one of the things that I see and I experience is that everything that I have seen as it relates to the great minds that have come through the world is that they have taught us that everything that we do is not for us. It is for us to be used as a vessel, as an instrument to give to somebody else. You know, a lot of folks get down into meditation and they come out and say, oh, I was feeling so good. But you know something? You didn't get down into meditation to feel good for you. You got down into meditation to be able to bring forward a positive energy to give to everyone around you. And we have to begin to think that for everything given to us, it is a gift from a creator source, and the only way that we could ever repay them is to give it to somebody else. That, I believe, is an ancient way of thinking. As opposed to getting something and keeping it for you, it is to get something to give it back to somebody. And I think if we start to think that way and to understand this, everything that we have begins to be shared, and in that sharing, because we're all not going to be sunlight, okay? Sunshine, See, the sun shines, the moon lights from the shine of the sun. And so all of us are not going to be sunshine. Some of us got to be moonlight. And I know that if, when it is my time to shine, if I shine on the moon for the day, and I become the moon the next day, and the sun that was the moon the day before becomes the sun, they'll share their light on me, and so we'll have sunshine and moonlight all the time. And that's what we have to start thinking about as a people, and we have to focus on our children, because we will only be as good as our children, because they are our future. And for all the folk that have all these problems with the young people, that I hear some of the elders say, what's wrong with the young people? I tell them all, go and look in the mirror, because what's wrong with our young people is us, because we didn't do what we were supposed to do. We're supposed to be dropping that knowledge with our children and telling them the truth, no matter how much controversy may be created, no matter how many problems. See, because I don't think that people say I'm controversial. I'm not controversial. The truth is controversial. And the fact they can't handle the truth is controversial. I'm not controversial. The truth is just something the person can't handle.
Well, I totally agree with you, Doctor. And I think too many times, you know, we have been subjugated to the fact that we're controversial, we're arrogant, we're this and that. And, you know, I think we're past it, the age and where we have to worry about what others think about us. We have to forge ahead for ourselves and for, like you said, for our children, because, you know, ain't nobody out there doing anything for us except us. So, you know what I'm saying? There's, you turn on the television, it doesn't have anything to do with us other than a menial role. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
You go work, you're working for someone else most of the time. You know what I'm saying? So we have to be concerned with ourselves and with our community, and we have to have that sense of community that we used to have back when my grandparents, you know what I'm saying, when I would go over my grandparents' house and they would tell me about when they, you know, how they lived. My mother would tell me about, and my father would tell me about when they were youngins. You know what I'm saying? It's like that sense of community has somehow gone away, and we need to bring that back. And
yes, man.
And I appreciate what you have done. Like, I honestly, like, that Hidden Colors thing is such a fabulous video. It's like, it's something that I could take to schools and show the children. Like, my children love it. Like, someone comes over, they're like, from Hidden Colors, you know what I mean? And they love
wow.
it. You know what I'm saying? It's unabashedly us. And it's not apologetic. It's just us, straightforward. It's just tell, like you said, it's just the truth. And there's a Dr. Karam on the line. He's at 3535. And no, I don't think that's the number. But yo, there's a brother on the line. Like, we would love to talk to you because we look at you as like an elder, someone who could give us guidance on what we're trying to do to help the youth. You know what I'm saying? So, I appreciate everything you do. I'm not going to take up your time, and I'll get off the line this time so someone else can get on. But again, I give all due respect and kudos and accolades to you, and please keep it coming. I've emailed you. Hopefully I can correspond with you in the future, because you are definitely someone I look to as an elder and someone I respect. So thank you very
brother,
much for
your work. Brother, I
appreciate
that. But before you go, brother, how old are your children?
My children are 13 and 8 years old.
Oh, that's fantastic that they would be focused on the Hidden Colors, man. You're doing a great job in showing it to them, man. I really appreciate you, man. You keep on, and we will be in correspondence, my brother.
All right, I appreciate that. Yeah, and you have a wonderful night. Hotel.
And you also, my brother. Stay strong, and we'll be talking soon.
Yes, Wadu.
Hotel.
No, so let me state this, too, that Professor Kaba is very accessible. If you have Facebook, put in his name, K-A-B-A. Hiawatha, which I will not spell here, Kamene, K-A-M-E-N-E. And as a matter of fact, it comes up on Brother Kaba Kamene. So you put in his name into Facebook, and you can actually have a conversation with him. Actually, this is how I was able to get him onto this show.
That's awesome.
And, you know, I try to use Facebook as communication with the community. That's, you know, I find, you know, it's not what it is, it's how you use it. And I know there's a lot of controversy around things, but Facebook for me is a wonderful thing because it allows me to communicate. And one of the things that a lot of folk comment on is that I do read Facebook, and I will respond to things time permitting and just things that I see some folk may say. I will respond to that, you know, and that's how I use Facebook to communicate. And, you know, when Brother El-Bey put on Facebook, you know, this conversation that we were going to have, and people who tuned into it and people who tuned know what I'm saying is that I will respond no matter who it is, no matter how it's put across. If somebody makes a provide, like, I'll tell you, man, them Adidas sneakers, man, when they came out, the Shackle sneakers, Adidas pulled them out, man. Adidas ain't going to go with the Shackle sneaker. But when I saw they, you know, they faced me on that. They showed it to me. They said, what did I think? You know, and I just made comment about that. So Facebook is a good thing when you're reaching out and you just want people's opinion, myself included. I do it with other people when I want to know something that I know that is their expertise. And so, I mean, feel free to reach out to me because I use it as a communication tool. And so, yeah, I'm on Facebook also, Kaba, K-A-B-A. And then my last name is K-A-M-E-N-E. And friend me, and we'll take it from there.
All right. You have it. We have another caller, and your code 313. Who are you calling from?
Peace. This is Tiffany. I'm calling from Detroit.
Detroit, 313. Hotel, Sister
313. And listen, it's crazy because I'm like, I know it's probably a billion people trying to get in, and look, I got in. But I want to say peace to you, Dr. Kaba. Peace to you, Brother Alim. Love you both. Love your work. Tremendous, tremendous impact on my life. But my question is, I hear a lot about the great separation, the separation that's going to come with the conscious and the unconscious. What does that look like? What would that be like?
Well, look, just look outside right now, Sister Tiffany. You'll see it.
It's crazy.
You know, I mean, this is what it is. You know, and the idea is like when I say the 3 out of 100, you know, we all have the potential, but there's just so much stuff. You know, it's like a cluttered room that has a jewel in the corner, and there's so many boxes and so much garbage that is put on top of it for so many of our people. And I have mercy on our people. I love our people, and I respect them greatly. Each and every one of them. But the bottom line is, they did a job on us. And we are continuing to allow them to continue this job because I don't give peoples of European descent that much credit. I don't think they're intelligent at all. In fact, I think the one thing that they do better than us, meaning peoples of African descent, is they know how to survive. They know 7 seconds before something happens that's going to snuff them out. And they put things in place that will stop it. Mm-hmm. The only thing they have on us, and that is because in their environment, in the ice, these Africans have to survive. In the southern climate, where the weather was very beautiful, and the climate and the weather and the food grew because Ra shone on the earth, they ate well, they lived well, they partied, they knew how to have a good time, they really didn't have the pressures of the Ice Age people. Although we had to live, we did not have to survive, so to speak, as we did in the Ice Age. So they learned over thousands of years how to survive the worst of times. And that's what they brought back amongst us. See, we lived a life that, when you look at us as a people, even today, we let them do a lot of stuff to us that they should never get away with. And that's basically our attitude. This is how we live. We all chilling and all the rest of that. Them, it's real life survival. And so for us as a people, there's so much stuff on us. You know, when I look to, and I mean, I guess brothers do it as it relates to sneakers, Brothers do it as it relates to various things that we are connected to the material world. Literally, our sisters are sending Asian children to school. We give their children scholarships by how much money we spend in the nail salons and in the hair salons. We literally are giving their children scholarships. That's how much money we spend there. People spent over $350 million on Chinese food. We spent $200 million on potato chip. Now, I don't need to say too much because brother who wrote Powernomics can drop that on you. But that consciousness is just not... You know, when I pass, you know, where I live here, there is a Chinese restaurant. All the Chinese people, you know, and at nighttime when I'm coming home, sometimes I'm coming home late, and they're closing shop and going home. They all smile at me and they laugh and they greet me because they know I ain't no fool. They never saw me go in their store. They're never going to see me go into their store. And it's not that I have a problem with them. It's that when was the last time you saw a soul food restaurant in one of the Chinatowns? It's not that they don't like black people. It's that they're just not going to patronize it. And when you don't patronize it, they don't make money. And when they don't make money, they got to close down. We keep them busy. So that consciousness and that separation, it is not so much a separation as I would see how we define the word separation. It's just a choice. It's a choice that they're going to have to make. You either going to get on board, or maybe, as Erica Badu said, maybe next lifetime.
Okay, wow. Thank you.
Dr. King was right, Sister Tiffany. We are going to get to the promised land. That's the good news. The bad news is a lot of us ain't going to make it.
Wow. That's powerful. Thank you. I'm going to get off the line and let the other people get through. Peace and blessings.
Right, thank you.
Give my regards to the family in Detroit.
I will do that. Thank you.
Last time I was there was with our good brother, Dr. Ray Higgins, when he had his convocation a couple years back in October.
Wow. I wish I saw that.
I love Detroit. I love the people there. Powerful, powerful.
I'm going to send you an email and get that package, so I'll be in touch with you.
Okay, sister. Just make sure you put study guide so that I'll know it's coming as a study guide. So I'll open up the mail. Because as you can imagine, I don't open up all my mail.
I don't blame you. I will do that.
Hey, my sister Tiffany. Don't tap.
All right. We have another call from 478. Area code 478. Where are you calling from?
Peace and blessings. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Hotep, I can hear you, brother.
Hotep, this is Dr. Karam. I'm calling from Macon, Georgia.
Hey, brother Karam. You were introduced by another brother. Said you were gonna make that call from Virginia.
Yes, I've been listening. And I did want to call and give my peace and blessings to you, brother, and also like the brother in Virginia. To share my appreciation for your wisdom and your peace with the hidden colors. You know, I have a school concept that I put together called the Kalu Academy, and the hidden colors is required material. it's a required listen or viewing before we begin our Nubian history course. So they got to watch that video before we even get started going into any textbooks. That's the impact that it had on me. I've written some books and things like that, and I've been listening. I didn't catch the whole show, but from what I've caught, you know, I'm really appreciative that this type of energy is out there, that this type of energy is being shared within the community, because like. You know, you mentioned in terms of just looking out the window. You know, it's kind of a sad situation in reference to just the vibrations of our people, and in reference to what we need for just any kind of salvation, any kind of help and assistance. It's going to have to come from us.
Yeah.
You know, a wise man always said, "The help that you need is at the end of your arm." you know. And if we use that end of our arm and grab hold with another one of ours and another one of ours, and we can pull that energy together, we can really do a lot. Community-wise,
yes,
in reference to going into our communities, I've noticed something. I went to visit Philadelphia, where my wife is from. I'm from Chicago originally. I've been in Virginia and different other places. I've noticed that in a lot of places, especially the big cities, they're doing what they call regentrification. And they're going into our communities, they're snatching up our property, and they're tearing it down and rebuilding these nice accommodations, moving us out, and then bringing their people in. I've put together a concept called the Kalu Center, which goes into our community and quietly but consistently puts together a program that regentrifies the community from inside out without taking nobody's property, without putting nobody out, but by changing the vibration of our community. Because what we find is when we're raising our children is that it's an environment that's very important. I have 7 children that I've been, you know, that are mine, as opposed to the other children that I've worked with my school. And the one thing that I found as a constant is that no matter what the information that's being presented, if there is no environment to support it, the information is not going to stick like it needs to. If I take my son and I put him in a karate class that's taught by somebody who does karate part-time, you know, he's full-time teacher or a full-time chef or a full-time police officer, but he does karate part-time. My son is going to get a part-time martial arts education, and he may not get the full benefit of what he can learn. Let's say if I put him in a Shaolin school, so the environment is conducive of him learning it all of the time. So we find that these information wars that we get into in our community really are beyond the point. The point is, if we can change the environment that our babies are in, and we can change the vibration. I do a lot of teaching about vibrations and the importance of vibration, how the human body vibrates at 207 normally, but love vibrates at 500 megahertz. So before we can even start talking about true love, we got to start vibrating even higher than we normally vibrate. But in reference to changing the vibrations of our community, if we change the environment, if we can create an environment, sort of an enclosed garden concept, similar to like the Garden of Eden concept, and we protect it, and
yes,
we protect it from the worst of us, as well as the worst of the world, and then put them babies in there and raise them and groom them as if they are royalty, like the genetics that they come from. And instead of telling them that they used to be great people, we groom them as if they are great people.
Uh-huh.
Grow up and you are the rulers. You are the pharaohs. You are the kings and princesses. I don't say queen because that's not a good word, but you were you were the ruling deity, the ruling class of the planet Earth, and this is how you carry yourself, and this is how you represent. And at the same time, while we're doing that, we're building the kingdom in which they will inherit. Looking at this, I'm really appreciative of what you're doing. I'm really appreciative of what you're sharing, of your expertise, of your wisdom, and of your experiences, because that is the pool that we want our youth to pull from. It's so many, you know, I have a saying, I look forward to when I can become a wise elder as opposed to an old fool. You know, because the wise elder are the ones who, by experience, in their experiences, in their study, they've applied the knowledge that they've come across. And through time and experience have become those wise elders, as opposed to people who just stuffed information in their head, didn't do anything with it. Now they want to sit back on their couches, you know, talking the game, but not doing anything about it. You know, they get a kick out of having the knowledge to be able to throw at somebody, but are not examples of that self-same information. So I look at, and I appreciate you as the wise elder you are. I wanted to build with you. I'm going to need to get your email again so that I can send you an email so I can get that information that you were speaking about earlier, the curriculum. And I look forward to really, you know, building with you in the future. and, you know, even meeting face-to-face so that we can sit down and really do some talking, because, you know, I know you got some things that you can share that can enhance what I'm doing with my school and with the other programs that I've been doing.
Absolutely, and I'm sure that's reciprocal also, brother. I can learn from you, so I'm sure that's possible, and that will happen. And my email, just to give it to you again, is KAMEE777. KAM as in Mary, E, N as in Nancy, E, 777 at AOL.com.
Okay. I got it.
And one of the things that you said about the environment and about, it was something that we had spoken about earlier, and as you said, my brother, you may not have been in the beginning, but we were talking about the importance of understanding the brain, and we were talking about the amygdala and the hippocampus. The amygdala is where fear resides, that many of our experiences, like I gave the example of if we were walking down the street and saw a huge anaconda snake, the amygdala would immediately be that piece of the brain, so to speak, that would be invigorated by that vision.
Okay.
And much of what we experience in this environment, the Western civilization, the politics of fear, keeps people fearful.
Right, right. Definitely. Definitely.
And everything is being taught to your amygdala. It's taught, if you don't pass this test, you're a failure. And this is, or you're never going to get this, and you're not intelligent. That's teaching to the amygdala. The hippocampus is responsible for long-term memory.
Okay.
And so if we created...
Are you there?
Yes, everyone here.
And that's why what you're saying is so important, because we have to create safe havens for our community and for our children. And out of that come everything, because I tell people all the time, it is not an achievement gap. They keep talking about the difference between the grades, between, let's just say, African-American children and Hispanic-American children, although Hispanic are African, they just speak Spanish, but that's a whole other point. And European-American children, they talk about an achievement gap. And I tell people it's not an achievement gap, it's an opportunity gap.
Definitely.
And if we gave our children the opportunity, they would shine like any other child. And between you and me, they shine brighter.
Yes, they do.
Because of the nature of their experience. Because Kwame Ture used to always teach us the idea that if you should give, if you have two children, that you give one child grows up, and everything that the child wants to do, you encourage that child. And that child achieves great things in their life. They're great. Another child, that every time that child tries to move forward, you do everything to discourage them.
Right.
Greater than the great child, not necessarily because they had it within them naturally, but because of the trials and tribulations that you put that child through. Yet despite and in spite of those, then great.
All right, I say.
America to have achieved what they achieved, whether they baker, teacher, doctor, or president, they had to be better than everybody. My mama used to bring me up to tell me, for a black man to be equal in America, you must be superior.
Right.
That's going to help us down the road. It's not fair, but it's going to help us.
Right.
Because we're going to be greater than great.
Exactly. And genetically, we always push forward in that direction anyway. We're great, and we're great at whatever we do.
Well, we are the original people, brother, so we got the DNA for all things, for all time, forevermore.
Exactly. Exactly.
European came out of us by mistake.
Right.
You know, and I'm not mad. That's science, man. I'm not mad at them. This is science. I'm not speaking superiority, inferiority. I'm basically saying it is only when we left our natural environment and went into the northern climate did we depigment ourselves. And J.A. Rogers says that when you take brown sugar and strip it of its protein, it becomes white sugar. When you take brown rice and strip it of its protein, it becomes white rice. And he says when you take a brown person and strip them of their protein, they become a white person. Uh-huh. That's science. That's not emotion. That's science.
And who were the original scientists but us?
And that's the bottom line. This is what we have to, our children have to be saturated in an understanding of the history of the world and create a safe haven. And I believe in a safe haven. I believe in a safe classroom. Because here in the Bronx, I have to create safe places for the children. So when they were with me, I wasn't going to let nothing happen to them. They were safe to express themselves. They were safe to be who they were. They were safe to be as wonderful. They were encouraged to be happy and sad.
Okay.
Let it out. I will not hold it against you. It is healthy to me. By the way, young brother or young sister, I felt that way myself sometimes.
Right, right.
Let it flow. Be yourself. Be happy. Careful. You got to know your friends from your enemies. But see, our problem, I think, brother, is as black folk, we haven't differentiated certain concepts. We have friends, we have enemies, and we have allies. And
right.
Sometimes, after the battle with our enemy is over, we still think the allies are our friends.
Right. But the
and
allies
your ally
have their own
can
agenda.
Become a more bitter enemy than your enemy was that you both defeated together.
Right.
And I always use the example of World War II, when we were fighting the Germans and the Japanese, and we were allies with the Chinese and the Russians. After the war, the Chinese and the Russians became our enemies, and the Japanese and the Germans became our friends. And that's because people know the difference between an ally and a friend. Sometimes we keep our allies around us too long. We got to cut them loose sometimes.
Right.
My brother, I look forward to building with you. I look forward to developing in whatever way I may be able to support you and reciprocally things that we can do together, brother. I look forward to the future.
All right. Wonderful. Beautiful talking to you, brother. You take care of yourself. Hotep.
Hotep, brother. Hotep. You also. Regards to the family in Macon, Georgia, brother.
All right. Definitely. I will.
Oh, yeah, the first caller that she was asking about is area code 253. That's from Texas.
Texas. Wow, okay. We down there now. Oh, we all over.
Oh, yeah. We have another caller here. Area code 321. Area code 321, you're on the line. Where you calling from, caller? All right, you're kind of low. Turn up your speaker and your headphone.
Okay. Yeah, hello?
Yeah, okay. I can hear you better now. Hotep.
I would just like the email, please. The email for us.
Okay, the email. You need your email, Brother Kaba.
Okay, the email. Kamene, Kamene, 777@AOL.com.
All right, thank you.
Okay, brother?
Yes.
Where was that brother calling from?
That brother called from Florida.
Florida, all right. I was just in Jacksonville a few weeks ago.
All
had
right.
a good time in Florida.
Right. Yeah, the South is hitting it.
Yes, it is, brother. No doubt about that.
All right, we have another caller from 757. Of course, that's back in Virginia area again. You're on the line.
Peace.
Peace.
Peace, brother.
Yeah, I just wanted to shout out the brother for your work and, you know, putting out the knowledge. And, you know, and also I wanted to shout the brother out earlier that had mentioned the gentrification. That's something that you rarely hear people talk about. And I see it a lot out here near where I am, and I'm actually closer to Washington, D.C., and the gentrification is really big up there. I mean, they're just, you know, just moving us out, and just all the areas that used to be, you know, crime ridden and had drug infested, and you can see how, you know, the process of, you know, the power structure bringing the drugs in, and all the devastation it brings to the community, and then they clear people out, and then they move other people in. And I mean, it's just a real, it's a real serious situation.
And you know what's interesting is here in New York City, you know, they do the same thing. But you know, the bottom line, my brother, is that all of this is going to work itself out eventually. I don't put a time limit on it, but all of this is going to work itself out as it relates to what is going around is coming around. Because, you see, the bottom line that we, when you look at history, see, I've often said that prophets are not psychics, they're just good historians. Because when you know what happened in the past, you can understand what's happening in the present, and you can predict the future. And so when you understand history and you tell somebody something in the present and then you experience the future and they say, wow, you said 3 years ago that this was going to happen. How did you know? Well, it's not like it's some divine intervention that touched your head and made you see it if you understand history. Basically, European people have always taken whatever we did. They've always wanted to live amongst us, although they don't particularly care for us. They've always wanted to live. It's like the parent that makes the seat comfortable, and when the parent, and then the child wants to sit in the seat where the parent was, because the parent made it right. Wherever we go, we bring life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness to it. And most folk want what we have. And so they will always do that. But what will change is, as the brother had said earlier, who spoke about the re-gentrification of the communities, is when the safe haven is created amongst African people, that creates the inability for them to be able to come in on you. See, we haven't gotten it right yet. And we've also elected people who look like us, who have not had our best interests at heart. And it's hard to name you anybody that is worth their weight in gold, because look at the conditions of our people in America with so many of them. I remember a day when Dawkins and Adam Clayton Powell were the only two African-Americans in Congress. And now you have a congressional black caucus, and what is being done for our community? Well, quite frankly, we have an African-American president. But see, we have to stop depending on other people for what we need to do for ourselves. Because I don't expect President Obama to do anything for me. When President Obama won the presidency, I was still in the mode as if John McCain had won. Once African people, and it was something I was going to say when the brother had been speaking earlier, about the way in which we have to set our minds. And what I've encouraged us to do is we need to stop blaming peoples of European descent for the position that we find ourselves in. But please let me finish what I was saying, because a lot of folk can't handle that. But I want you to say, I understand who put us in this position. I understand how we got here. I understand the treachery, the treachery and the lies and the deceit. that got us in this position. I understand what they did. My problem is that when you find yourself in a particular position, and when you blame somebody else for the position you find yourself in, while you blame them for putting you in this position, you also give them the power to keep you in that position or to take you out. When we accept full responsibility, of which I do, I am to blame for the conditions we find ourselves in educationally. And when I accept full responsibility for the education of our people, then I can do what I need to do by any means necessary, what needs to be done for our people. If I'm blaming European Americans and the educational system for what's going on, then I give them the power to keep doing it or stop doing it. I am saying I don't care what you do, I am going to make the changes myself, and we have to take responsibility. And again, I'm going to say, I'm not saying I don't understand what they did to us. I am saying psychologically, as long as we depend on somebody else to do for us, instead of depending on ourselves, it will never be done. Because if the person that oppressed you, if you depend on them not to oppress you, my question is, if they would stop oppressing you, why did they even start oppressing you in the first place? So I'm not going to give you that power to continue to oppress me, because I'm not going to give you the dynamics and the tools to do that. We must take full responsibility for ourselves and our families and our communities and begin to do the things necessary by any means necessary. The regentrification, we need to go into our communities, and we need to build up the communities so that that can't happen, as opposed to telling them to stop doing it. Let's do something that will stop them anyway.
I think it is best said, too, in the book that I read years ago, they stole it, but you must return it.
Yes. Yes.
We have
that's my bottom
caller.
Line.
Yeah. We have 10 more minutes, and we have another caller, and this area code is 510. Area code 510, you're on the line. Where you calling from?
Hello?
Caller?
Hello?
Yes, where you calling from? Yes.
I'm coming from Oakland, California.
Oakland, California.
Oakland, California. Oh, the land of the Black Panther Party.
All right.
Yeah, definitely. I was honored to find out recently, this last week, that that's actually my spirit animal and shit.
I'm sorry, brother. I didn't hear that last part that you said.
I was saying I was honored this last week to go into meditation and find out that that is my spirit animal, the Black Panther.
All right.
And
no
I'm
doubt about it. Diplomatic by nature, dangerous when provoked.
Yeah. Definitely. And it's odd because I'm glad you guys are talking about brain expansion today, because I was watching the movie Limitless, and I was thinking, you know what, instead of applying that to something outside of me, why not apply that to my pineal gland? And as soon as I did that, over this last week, things have been getting crazy. I'll be thinking of something, things will manifest, and like, it'll be in the next 5 seconds without even having to try anything really deeply. It'll just be me just saying, I need this, and then instantly, like, earlier today, I wanted cigarettes and stuff for no reason, but sure enough, I get to the house, Mom bought me a pack of stuff. I'm like, dang, and she left me some money, so I'm like, dang, it's really, this time is really getting powerful, and our energy and our natural powers are really getting powerful.
Yeah. Well, brother, I want you to get those powers real, you know, those natural powers real powerful, so you can even talk yourself out of smoking cigarettes.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So
work
like
on that, brother, because we need you healthy.
Definitely. I've been getting more into trying to use it for a more ancient spiritual way of using it, even though it's been tampered with and not the natural thing. I'm like, we brothers, we the natural beings, we the original beings. We can tap into things even if it's been tampered with. We can use our melanin to adapt to the situation and get what we need out of it.
No doubt about that, brother man. Have you ever heard of a man by the name of Pascal Beverly Randolph?
I have heard of him.
Yeah, you need to get his biography, brother. Read about him. You'll find his life story very interesting. He lived between 1825 and
1875. Oh, wow.
Check out his biography, brother. I think what you're going through you might find very interesting as it relates to him.
Okay, definitely.
Pascal Beverly Randolph.
Could you spell that for me?
P-A-S-C-H-A-L. Pascal. P-A-S-C-H-L, Beverly,
okay.
E-V-E-R,
I'm on Google.
Randolph, R-A-N-D-O-L-P-H.
Okay, it just came up.
No.
All right, well, thanks, brother. I got, like, the other day I was glad you touched on the, or glad Aline touched on the, zombie subject the other day or last week's show, because the week before, I know Delta Blair had actually had a show where he got into it about that too, and I was like wondering what in the hell. Then I started thinking, if this is coming up, then it must mean we need to definitely get into our knowledge of self and whatnot, because I had a vision last month and I witnessed the apocalypse. Like, I witnessed the end, and it was just showing me that, like, I need to really start trusting myself and honoring myself and really getting into knowing that, knowing who I am instead of just thinking about it, just knowing it.
No doubt, brother. No doubt. So keep on keeping on.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you. And thank you, brother.
Otep. All right, we at the end of the show. We thank you, thank you, thank you, Brother Professor Kaba, for coming on.
Oh, yes,
the line.
Brother.
And anytime that you want to come on, please feel free, you know, to communicate that, and we'd love to have you back.
Doubt, brother. We're going to work something out, brother. I'm very happy to have been on this program, brother. I thank you for extending the invitation to me, and I just appreciate this opportunity to talk to the family and to build on knowledge and wisdom. And we just have to keep on keeping on and understand our ancestors would never have brought us this far to leave us this way.
That's right.
It ain't over till we win, and after we win, then we got to get busy.
That's right.
And so I encourage us as a people, man, we have a wonderful experience to celebrate, and we just got to keep on working at it. We have to get serious about getting serious.
No doubt about it. We thank you once again, Hotep, and for the family.
First World Order Radio, finally. We are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence, an indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the same as your thoughts transmits it. Burn. Perceiving in others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. World. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. And indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Radio. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages for us to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories and shit that works.